Perpustakaan yang dilengkapi dengan ratusan buku untuk referensi, sekaligus berbagai hasil penelitian mahasiswa Universitas Kadiri. Laboratorium komputer dengan berbagai alat yang memadai, dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Laboratorium bahasa yang dilengkapi dengan fasilitas full internet, dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Galeri investasi merupakan sarana untuk pembelajaran dan diskusi bersama tentang pasar modal. Laboratorium sipil dan laboratorium industri, greenhouse dan laboratorium pertanian, peradilan semu, laboratorium farmasi, ruang microteaching, dan aula sebagai sarana kegiatan para mahasiswa. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam prestasi, antara lain klasterisasi perguruan tinggi urutan 48 pada klaster 4, SIM Katmawa peringkat 102 nasional. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam unit kegiatan mahasiswa atau UKM yang berprestasi, antara lain UKM Kerohanian Islam, juara 3 Tilawah Quran 2019, UKM Olahraga Futsal, juara 1 futsal antar mahasiswa se-Jawa Timur, mahasiswa berprestasi nasional, juara 1 Pekan Olahraga Mahasiswa Nasional 2019, mahasiswa berprestasi internasional, juara 1 Tenis Meja Internasional, UKM Seni Menyanyi, juara 2 nasional, dan Galeri Investasi memperoleh prestasi juara 1 Banking and Finance Festival. Mari bergabung bersama Universitas Kadiri untuk mewujudkan cita-cita Anda. Bingung kuliah di mana? Universitas Kadiri mempunyai 6 fakultas dan 21 program studi. Fakultas Hukum, program studi S1 Hukum dan S2 Hukum. Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik, program studi S1 Administrasi Publik dan S2 Administrasi Publik. Fakultas Pertanian, program studi S1 Agroteknologi dan S1 Agribisnis. Fakultas Ekonomi, program studi S1 Ekonomi Pembangunan, S1 Manajemen, dan S2 Manajemen. Fakultas Teknik, program studi S1 Teknik Sipil dan S1 Teknik Industri. Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan, program studi D3 Kebidanan, D4 Kebidanan, S1 Kebidanan, Pendidikan Profesi Bidan, S1 Keperawatan, Pendidikan Profesi Nurse, S1 Farmasi, D4 Teknik Laboratorium Medis, D3 Teknik Elektromedis, dan Pendidikan Profesi Apoteker. Info pendaftaran. Ketik link http://pendaftaran.unik-kediri.ac.id/. Tata cara pendaftaran. Setelah terbuka halaman awal pendaftaran, lalu pilih daftar atau daftar kesehatan untuk Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan. Masukkan data diri Anda. Login dengan menggunakan NIK dan password yang Anda masukkan. Halaman dashboard setelah login, lalu bayar biaya pendaftaran menggunakan nomor virtual account yang didapatkan. Jika sudah, akan mendapatkan nomor pendaftaran dan bisa melakukan tes online pada tautan yang ada di dashboard. Jika dinyatakan diterima, kemudian upload dokumen yang dibutuhkan. Kemudian bayar tagihan registrasi dengan nomor virtual account yang diperoleh. Registrasi mahasiswa baru untuk mendapatkan NIM. Isi data diri dengan benar dan lengkap sesuai dengan isian yang diminta. Universitas Kadiri memiliki 4 jalur pendaftaran. Jalur prestasi. Untuk calon mahasiswa yang lulus pada 2 tahun terakhir atau bebas tes, dengan mengunggah prestasi minimal di tingkat regional atau menggunakan nilai rata-rata rapot 8-10. Jalur KIPK. Jalur KIPK merupakan beasiswa untuk calon mahasiswa yang kurang mampu dan memiliki kemampuan akademik dan telah terdaftar di laman kip-kuliah.kemendikbud.go.id. Jalur reguler. Jalur reguler untuk semua calon mahasiswa baru lulusan SMA atau sederajat yang mendaftar di Universitas Kadiri. Dan jalur transfer. Jalur transfer untuk mahasiswa pindahan atau alih jenjang atau lintas jalur di semua angkatan. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam fasilitas seperti Gedung Olahraga Surya Kadiri yang digunakan para mahasiswa untuk kegiatan olahraga. Dalam Gor Surya Universitas Kadiri juga dilengkapi fasilitas olahraga seperti basket, futsal, bulu tangkis, tenis meja, dan fitness center. Musola. Perpustakaan yang dilengkapi dengan ratusan buku untuk referensi, sekaligus berbagai hasil penelitian mahasiswa Universitas Kadiri. Laboratorium komputer dengan berbagai alat yang memadai, dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Laboratorium bahasa yang dilengkapi dengan fasilitas full internet, dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Galeri investasi merupakan sarana untuk pembelajaran dan diskusi bersama tentang pasar modal. Laboratorium sipil dan laboratorium industri. Greenhouse dan laboratorium pertanian. Peradilan semu. Laboratorium farmasi. Ruang microteaching. Dan aula sebagai sarana kegiatan para mahasiswa. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam prestasi, antara lain klasterisasi perguruan tinggi urutan 48 pada klaster 4. SIM Katmawa peringkat 102 nasional. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam unit kegiatan mahasiswa atau UKM yang berprestasi. Antara lain, UKM Kerohanian Islam, juara 3 Tilawah Quran 2019. UKM Olahraga Futsal, juara 1 futsal antar mahasiswa se-Jawa Timur. Mahasiswa berprestasi nasional, juara 1 Pekan Olahraga Mahasiswa Nasional 2019. Mahasiswa berprestasi internasional, juara 1 Tenis Meja Internasional. UKM Seni Menyanyi, juara 2 nasional. Dan Galeri Investasi memperoleh prestasi, juara 1 Banking and Finance Festival. Mari bergabung bersama Universitas Kadiri untuk mewujudkan cita-cita Anda. Bingung kuliah di mana? Universitas Kadiri mempunyai 6 fakultas dan 21 program studi. Fakultas Hukum, program studi S1 Hukum dan S2 Hukum. Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik, program studi S1 Administrasi Publik dan S2 Administrasi Publik. Fakultas Pertanian, program studi S1 Agroteknologi dan S1 Agribisnis. Fakultas Ekonomi, program studi S1 Ekonomi Pembangunan, S1 Manajemen, dan S2 Manajemen. Fakultas Teknik, program studi S1 Teknik Sipil dan S1 Teknik Industri. Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan, program studi D3 Kebidanan, D4 Kebidanan, S1 Kebidanan, Pendidikan Profesi Bidan, S1 Keperawatan, Pendidikan Profesi Nurse, S1 Farmasi, D4 Teknik Laboratorium Medis, D3 Teknik Elektromedis, dan Pendidikan Profesi Apoteker. Info pendaftaran. Ketik link http://pendaftaran.unik-kediri.ac.id/. Tata cara pendaftaran. Setelah terbuka halaman awal pendaftaran, lalu pilih daftar atau daftar kesehatan untuk Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan. Masukkan data diri Anda. Login dengan menggunakan NIK dan password yang Anda masukkan. Halaman dashboard setelah login, lalu bayar biaya pendaftaran menggunakan nomor virtual account yang didapatkan. Jika sudah, akan mendapatkan nomor pendaftaran dan bisa melakukan tes online pada tautan yang ada di dashboard. Jika dinyatakan diterima, kemudian upload dokumen yang dibutuhkan. Kemudian, bayar tagihan registrasi dengan nomor virtual account yang diperoleh. Registrasi mahasiswa baru untuk mendapatkan NIK. Isi data diri dengan benar dan lengkap sesuai dengan isian yang diminta. Universitas Kadiri memiliki 4 jalur pendaftaran. Jalur prestasi. Untuk calon mahasiswa yang lulus pada 2 tahun terakhir atau bebas tes, dengan mengunggah prestasi minimal di tingkat regional atau menggunakan nilai rata-rata rapot 8-10. Jalur KIPK. Jalur KIPK merupakan beasiswa untuk calon mahasiswa yang kurang mampu dan memiliki kemampuan akademik dan telah terdaftar di laman kip-kuliah.kemendikbud.go.id. Jalur reguler. Jalur reguler untuk semua calon mahasiswa baru lulusan SMA atau sederajat yang mendaftar di Universitas Kadiri. Dan jalur transfer. Jalur transfer untuk mahasiswa pindahan atau alih jenjang atau lintas jalur di semua angkatan. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam fasilitas seperti Gedung Olahraga Surya Kadiri yang digunakan para mahasiswa untuk kegiatan olahraga. Dalam Gor Surya Universitas Kadiri juga dilengkapi fasilitas olahraga seperti basket, futsal, bulu tangkis, tenis meja, dan fitness center. Musola. Perpustakaan yang dilengkapi dengan ratusan buku untuk referensi, sekaligus berbagai hasil penelitian mahasiswa Universitas Kadiri. Laboratorium komputer dengan berbagai alat yang memadai dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Laboratorium bahasa yang dilengkapi dengan fasilitas full internet dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Galeri investasi merupakan sarana untuk pembelajaran dan diskusi bersama tentang pasar modal. Laboratorium sipil dan laboratorium industri. Greenhouse dan laboratorium pertanian. Peradilan semu. Laboratorium farmasi. Ruang microteaching. dan aula sebagai sarana kegiatan para mahasiswa. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam prestasi, antara lain klasterisasi perguruan tinggi urutan 48 pada klaster 4, SIM Katmawa peringkat 102 nasional. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam unit kegiatan mahasiswa atau UKM yang berprestasi, antara lain UKM Kerohanian Islam, juara 3 Tilawah Quran 2019, UKM Olahraga Futsal, juara 1 Futsal antar mahasiswa se-Jawa Timur, mahasiswa berprestasi nasional, juara 1 Pekan Olahraga Mahasiswa Nasional 2019, mahasiswa berprestasi internasional, juara 1 Tenis Meja Internasional, UKM Seni Menyanyi, juara 2 Nasional, dan Galeri Investasi memperoleh prestasi juara 1 Banking and Finance Festival. Mari bergabung bersama Universitas Kadiri untuk mewujudkan cita-cita Anda. Bingung kuliah di mana? Universitas Kadiri mempunyai 6 fakultas dan 21 program studi. Fakultas Hukum, program studi S1 Hukum dan S2 Hukum. Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik, program studi S1 Administrasi Publik dan S2 Administrasi Publik. Fakultas Pertanian, program studi S1 Agroteknologi dan S1 Agribisnis. Fakultas Ekonomi, program studi S1 Ekonomi Pembangunan, S1 Manajemen, dan S2 Manajemen. Fakultas Teknik, program studi S1 Teknik Sipil dan S1 Teknik Industri. Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan, program studi D3 Kebidanan, D4 Kebidanan, S1 Kebidanan, Pendidikan Profesi Bidan, S1 Keperawatan, Pendidikan Profesi Nurse, S1 Farmasi, D4 Teknik Laboratorium Medis, D3 Teknik Elektromedis, dan Pendidikan Profesi Apoteker. Info pendaftaran. Ketik link http://pendaftaran.unik-kediri.ac.id/. Tata cara pendaftaran. Setelah terbuka halaman awal pendaftaran, lalu pilih daftar atau daftar kesehatan untuk Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan. Masukkan data diri Anda. Login dengan menggunakan NIK dan password yang Anda masukkan. Halaman dashboard setelah login, lalu bayar biaya pendaftaran menggunakan nomor virtual account yang didapatkan. Jika sudah, akan mendapatkan nomor pendaftaran dan bisa melakukan tes online pada tautan yang ada di dashboard. Jika dinyatakan diterima, kemudian upload dokumen yang dibutuhkan. Kemudian bayar tagihan registrasi dengan nomor virtual account yang diperoleh. Registrasi mahasiswa baru untuk mendapatkan NIM. Isi data diri dengan benar dan lengkap sesuai dengan isian yang diminta. Universitas Kadiri memiliki 4 jalur pendaftaran. Jalur prestasi. Untuk calon mahasiswa yang lulus pada 2 tahun terakhir atau bebas tes, dengan mengunggah prestasi minimal di tingkat regional atau menggunakan nilai rata-rata rapot 8-10. Jalur KIPK. Jalur KIPK merupakan beasiswa untuk calon mahasiswa yang kurang mampu dan memiliki kemampuan akademik dan telah terdaftar di laman kip-kuliah.kemendikbud.go.id. Jalur reguler. Jalur reguler untuk semua calon mahasiswa baru lulusan SMA atau sederajat yang mendaftar di Universitas Kadiri. Dan jalur transfer. Jalur transfer untuk mahasiswa pindahan atau alih jenjang atau lintas jalur di semua angkatan. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam fasilitas seperti Gedung Olahraga Surya Kadiri yang digunakan para mahasiswa untuk kegiatan olahraga. Dalam Gor Surya Universitas Kadiri juga dilengkapi fasilitas olahraga seperti basket, futsal, bulu tangkis, tenis meja, dan fitness center. Musola. Perpustakaan yang dilengkapi dengan ratusan buku untuk referensi, sekaligus berbagai hasil penelitian mahasiswa Universitas Kadiri. Laboratorium komputer dengan berbagai alat yang memadai dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Laboratorium bahasa yang dilengkapi dengan fasilitas full internet dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Galeri investasi merupakan sarana untuk pembelajaran dan diskusi bersama tentang pasar modal. Laboratorium sipil dan laboratorium industri, greenhouse dan laboratorium pertanian, peradilan semu, laboratorium farmasi, ruang microteaching, dan aula sebagai sarana kegiatan para mahasiswa. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam prestasi, antara lain klasterisasi perguruan tinggi urutan 48 pada klaster 4, SIM Katmawa peringkat 102 nasional. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam unit kegiatan mahasiswa atau UKM yang berprestasi, antara lain UKM Kerohanian Islam, juara 3 Tilawah Quran 2019, UKM Olahraga Futsal, juara 1 futsal antar mahasiswa se-Jawa Timur, mahasiswa berprestasi nasional, juara 1 Pekan Olahraga Mahasiswa Nasional 2019, mahasiswa berprestasi internasional, juara 1 Tenis Meja Internasional, UKM Seni Menyanyi, juara 2 nasional, dan Galeri Investasi memperoleh prestasi juara 1 Banking and Finance Festival. Mari bergabung bersama Universitas Kadiri untuk mewujudkan cita-cita Anda.
International Webinar about Participatory Democracy, Civil Society and Diploma in Docency for Century will be begin. Please have a nice seat in your room, in your office, or wherever you are. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, good day for you all. Welcome to our international webinar held by Law Faculty Kadi University Indonesia with the title Participatory Democracy, Civil Society and Diploma in the 21st Century with the Honorable Speaker from Morocco, Brunei Darussalam and Indonesia. Welcome to our webinar for Mr. Yosef Bakil from Morocco, Dr. Ahmad Masum from Brunei Darussalam, and Mr. Fitri from Kadir University, Indonesia. Thank you for your willingness for joining this seminar. And then next, give our respect to Indonesian, Morocco, and Brunei Darussalam anthem.
Madrid.
Next agenda is the welcoming speech of Faculty Dean of Kadir University Indonesia, Honorable Dr. Lili Sudarmanto M. Hum. H.H.M. Hum, the time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Honorable Rector of Kadir University, Insinyur Joko Raharjo M.P. Honorable Yusuf Bagil, the General Secretary of Center of Research and Studies on Migration and Human Rights, Faculty of Law and Political Science, Hasan Peres University, Morocco. Dr. Ahmad Masum, Senior Assistant Professor, the Head of Law Program at the Faculty of Syariah and Law, University Islam Sultan Syarif Ali Brunei Darussalam. Fitri Windadi, SPD SHMH, Lecturer of the
Recording
Law
in Progress,
Kadiri University Indonesia, and seminar participant. Good afternoon and greeting to all of us. First of all, let us express our gratitude to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, because with His permission today, June 12, 2021, we can attend this international seminar with the theme Participatory Democracy, Civil Society and Development in the 21st Century. Basically, democracy is something that's already familiar in Indonesia. Democracy allows citizens to participate either directly or indirectly or through representative in the formulation, development, and the making of law. The most suitable democracy to be implemented in Indonesia in democracy based on Pancasila. Because in Pancasila democracy, the people are given freedom of opinion to organize on to choose their own leaders. So it is clear that people participate is very decisive in the development of democracy in Indonesia. Democracy in 21st century is strongly influenced by development of information technology, so that the role of citizen is very comprehensive or in our sector of life. There is almost the time and place limit to understand how participatory democracy, civil society, and development in the 21st century. Let's together follow the opinion of the speakers in the seminar. We hope this seminar can be useful for the student, peoples, nation, and states. Last but not least, I would like to thank the speakers and our committee who worked on this seminar. Finally, welcome for joining in this international seminar. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Mr. Henry, for the nice welcoming speech. Now, next we come to the seminar presentation with the first speaker from Brunei Darussalam. But first of all, I would like to introduce him first to the audience. Dr. Ahmad Masum is the Senior Assistant Professor and the Head of Law Program of the Faculty of Syariah and Law, University Islam Sultan Syarif Ali, or UNISA, Brunei Darussalam. He is also got the education from LLB or FOMS, Master of Comparative Law, MSL, and PhD, specializing in Constitutional Law from the International Islamic University, Malaysia. And then he also published several academic articles in different Scopus and IT journal, and also research interests include constitutional law, and then administrative law, public international law, human rights law, and jurisprudence and legal theory, criminal law, etc. Okay, it is about Dr. Ahmad Masum. Hello, doctor.
Hello.
Are you ready for your presentation?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, thank you for welcoming to Kadiri University seminar.
Yes.
Now, for you to deliver your presentation, sir, the time is about 20 minutes and 10 minutes for delivering asking and question answer. Are you ready, sir?
Okay, can you just share the slides?
Okay, sure. Okay, yeah. Thank you. The time is yours.
Okay. Thank you.
Madrid.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
First and foremost, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the organizer of Qadir University for inviting me to be part of this international webinar. So my title for the presentation this afternoon, it is basically related to the topic, that is participatory democracy and civil society as pillars of development in the 21st century. Next slide, please. So this is how I'm going to tackle the presentation. First of all, I will very briefly give you an introduction. Then I will try to share with the audience the meaning of participatory democracy, civil society, and development as well. Then why is participatory democracy and civil society very important in the context of development in the 21st century? Then I will move on to look at who are the participants of participatory democracy and civil society. I will touch on the challenges, and then I will move on to look at how to make participatory democracy and civil society work. And then finally is our conclusion there. Next slide, please. So basically, I will just wrap up the introduction very quick. So when you look at governments today, you realize that we are talking about elective democracy. So in some countries, every after 4 years, they go for election. In some countries, every after 5 years, they go for election. But the problem with elective democracy is that they operate with short-term vision. So meaning to say that there is no long-term vision. And of course, when you talk about elective democracy or representative democracy, we have problems. There is, for instance, in some countries, there is basically lack of free and fair election, low turnout, corruption, etc. And of course, in order to overcome these problems, participatory democracy seems to be the answer. Next slide, please. So basically, participatory democracy is based on consensus, unlike elective democracy. With elective democracy, we are talking about basically the majority. And if you look at basically participatory democracy, and on the other side, if you look at civil society, basically civil society plays an important role, which I'll be discussing in a moment. But the most important point there is that it is viewed as playing the role of balance of power between the state and society, improving on accountability of both politicians and administrators, and also legitimating the political system by promoting values of liberal democracy. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, no, next. Go up, please. Up. Okay, so we have to basically know what is actually meant by participatory democracy and also civil society. So when you talk about participatory democracy, it is basically a model of democracy in which citizens have the power to make decisions. So participatory democracy emphasizes the broad participation of people in politics. So in other words, it is not just about election after 4 years, after 5 years, no. So participatory democracy basically calls for citizens' engagement. The citizens are engaged in decision-making process. Now, the other important point, of course, with participatory democracy here is that it basically helps. For instance, like in countries practicing federalism, we have the federal government, then we have the state government, or we have countries basically whereby they have the central government, and then they have, for instance, like in Indonesia, you have the central government in Jakarta, but then you also have what? Basically, the states are operating also separately. Next slide, please. So basically, this information there is to show to you basically that your opinion matters when it comes to participatory democracy. And then the other basically information down there, it tells you that politicians should stop lying, because that's why we are saying that we want the citizens to get involved in the political decision making process of their country. Next slide, please. So if you look at Article 25 of the international civil code of procedure there. So basically the article is very important. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. So if you look at the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, Article 25 stipulates that every citizen shall have the right and opportunity to take part in the conduct of public affairs, the right to vote, and the right to have access to public services. So I just want to say something very quick here. So if you look at Article 25, we are talking about that citizens, they have the right to take part in the conduct of their public affairs. So how are they going to do that? Citizens will do that through participatory democracy. So in other words, we don't want to see the citizens getting involved only during the election period. For instance, when government, you're supposed to make some major decisions through participatory democracy, you go back to the grassroots or through referendum and ask for their opinions. So you can basically see participatory democracy taking place over there. Next slide, please. Now, what about civil society? That was participatory democracy. What about civil society? Now, civil society can be defined loosely as a society that embraces democracy. Now, civil society basically is a collective term for all types of actions by individuals or groups that do not emanate from the state and act not run by it. So in other words, when you talk about civil society, one of the main characteristics of a civil society is that it should be independent. It should be what? Independent. Because if it is not independent, then it cannot act as the check and balance. And that is why we are saying that civil society basically comprised of what? Organizations working in the interest of the citizens by operating outside the government and for non and for and not for profit what sectors. So basically civil society here, I will give you an example. For instance, like in a country we have, for instance, like organizations or associations. For instance, we have like organization dealing with human rights, the Human Rights Commission, for instance, in a given country. So that is an example of a civil society. You have the churches, you have the religious leaders, you have basically the institutions. So these are the civil societies you're talking about here. And if you look at, for instance, an international level, we have basically the Amnesty International is a very good example of a civil society. Next slide, please. So basically these are some of the you can look at speak up, stand up, show up for justice. This is one good example of participatory democracy. We are talking about basically stop corruption. We are talking about end the violence against Asians. Because if you remember very well, during the Trump administration and even of recent, so basically there was issue involving minorities, Asians, African-Americans, etc. So through participatory democracy or through civil society, they basically bring this to the attention of the people. Next slide, please. So why is participatory democracy considered a pillar of development? So basically we know what development is all about. Development can be economic development, it can be social development, it can be political development, it can be cultural development, etc. So when you talk about, so the question that I have posed here is why participatory democracy is a pillar of development? Because the theme of our conference here is about participatory democracy, civil society, and development in the 21st century. Now we have to pose a question, and the question is why participatory democracy is a pillar of development. So I will just share with you some of the reasons very quick. One of the reasons, of course, it is about transparency or improved governance. Why there is transparency, why there is improved government? Because through participatory democracy, we are talking about political involvement. We are talking about political engagement. So meaning to say that as a government, You don't need the citizens only during elections. You need the citizens all the time, most of the time, and always. You need them. For instance, when it comes to making political decisions that would affect them, you have to basically go back to the grassroots. Now, so this is very, very important. And that is why we are saying that how can we basically inculcate that participatory democracy? That basically can be achieved by way of development of culture of participation through civic education. So we cannot just talk about participatory democracy without civic education. So in other words, it is the responsibility of the civil society. It is the responsibility of I and you to basically educate the masses about that their voice matters. Their voice matters as far as the running of the country is concerned. And of course, we are also talking about what? That it can also monitor the work of the executive and state apparatus. So in other words, if we talk about participatory democracy, it also acts as a check and balance. So meaning to say that the government basically knows that someone is watching at what basically it is doing. Next slide, please. So another important point, why is participatory democracy a pillar of development? Because participatory democracy is all about redistribution. The poor can actively involve in the process of resource allocation. Because in every society or in every community or in every country, we are talking about basically what? We have the haves and the haves not. We have the rich and we have the poor. So one important aspect of participatory democracy, resources can be allocated to those who are really in need. And that, of course, at the end of the day, it will avoid wastage of what? Resources. Because when it comes to community-led decision-making process, we are basically saying that it should hold real, tangible value, not to be regulated to trivial and theoretical exercises. They should have power over significant budget policies. For instance, today when we talk about participatory democracy, we are talking about what? Participatory budgeting. Now, participatory budgeting is basically a concept which is very, very important when you talk about participatory what? Democracy. We have seen that working in Brazil. We have seen that working in basically the Kerala, for example, declaration. And then finally, next slide, please. Next slide. Now, another important, next up, go up a bit. Okay. Another important point here is improved quality of services. It allows practical based knowledge to be shared, debated, and finally implemented. For instance, services such as educational, medical, transport, etc. So in other words, the government is always on its toes, meaning to say that the government here, basically, if you're going to come up with services, you make sure that basically this is to improve the quality of the people. So in other words, improved quality of what? Services. So if you look at basically the demonstration down there, the demonstration speaks volume. That is basically that education is not about the cost, but it is basically about investment. So which is very, very important point. Next slide, please. Now, again, this is very important. Increased bargaining power with the private sector. Because when you talk about participatory democracy, we are looking at also basically the financial aspect is also very important. Because here we are looking at how basically, because we have the public sector, we have the private sector. Now, it is very, very important that when basically the private sector is coming in to do business in a given country, then we also have to take note of that certain important things are basically put on what? On the table. For instance, issue of employment. When you're going to operate a factory in a given place, then make sure that basically employment is also created to the people there. Not only that, you make sure that the environment is also what? Protected. And not only that, you also make sure that small businesses are also protected. So through participatory democracy, basically, we are able to achieve all that. Now, the other important point, of course, better policy and implementation decisions are made through participatory democracy. Next slide, please. So you can basically see, change the politics, not the climate. This is about basically climate. How do you protect Mother Nature? How do we basically say to basically issue of destroying what? The environment. Because if you destroy the environment, you destroy the climate. Today we are talking about global warming. But through participatory democracy, people will basically speak out their mind, and then the government will make the right decision. Next slide, please. Now, another important point, of course, is the E, is the point of political legitimation. So basically, it's certainly an improvement in public affairs when government administrators incorporate how might the public react. That is very important. So before you make a decision as a government, you got to ask yourself, what about my people? Because remember, you are there because of them. And the same people, if they want, they will remove you, they will remove you out through what? The electoral process. That is why we are saying that it should not just stop with election. For instance, if in a country after every 4 years you have an election, you say that you should not ignore the citizens. You should listen to their voices. You should listen to their grievances. Now, it is the same thing here. So in other words, we are saying that if you are the government, and as far as your government plans are concerned, you have this in mind, how might the public react? Then, of course, you're going to basically make sure that you come up with proper word, decisions, in order the public not to be offended with your word, with your decisions. Next. Now we are looking, that was participatory democracy. Now, the other question then is with regard to why is civil society a pillar of development? Now, we have looked at participatory democracy. Now, when it comes to civil society, this is very important. Basically, civil society, point number one there, filling gaps in services. Because at times the government is unable to provide all the services. And because the government is unable to provide all the services, maybe due to external factors, like lack of resources, for instance. Now, the good news here is that civil societies will come into picture to provide such services. That is very, very important. Now, the other important point, of course, why is it important? Pillar of development, we have to look at the issue with regard to affording, basically advocating for the marginalized and disenfranchised world, people. So in other words, it is seen as agent of change. For instance, protecting basically the weak, you get the point, countering corruption. We are talking about rule of law, lack of inclusiveness, and also human rights violation. So these are played by the civil societies. So in other words, the civil societies will come out and tell you that as a government, something is wrong here. Next, please. So you can basically see, this is basically how they work. We are talking about cultural rights being protected by a civil society there. Stop Asian hate. We are looking at how minority rights are being protected as well. So this is what basically civil society will do. Next. Now, the other important point, of course, it is also acting as a check and balance. So in other words, civil societies improve the quality of governance. So in other words, civil societies, basically what do? They keep an eye on government and businesses, ever alert for corruption, waste of resources, violation of rights, and inequalities. So in other words, because of civil societies, the government is basically being watched, and the government is put under pressure to deliver for basically the people. Next, please. Now, the other important point, of course, promote collective action. Because remember, that's what we have said earlier. You cannot have participatory democracy without basically inculcating the habit of civic education. The masses, the public, they need to be educated. That is why we are saying that it promotes collective action as far as civil societies are concerned. They increase opportunities for interaction, networking, and consensus building among citizens. They also raise awareness of public policy issues, like we have addressed issue of how can minority rights be protected? How can we fight corruption? And then, of course, they also advocate for the idea of transparency and accountability of both governments and business. So in other words, someone is watching the government. And who is that someone watching the government? The civil societies. They play an important role there. Next, please. There are also sources of information. Now, this is again very, very important. That's why we're saying that keep, you're not supposed to keep quiet. You're supposed to report it. For instance, if we have civil societies in our countries, what will they do? For instance, if there is a case of violation of human rights, they will bring that to the attention of the people. If, for instance, there is a case of minority people being marginalized, they will bring that also on the table. So in other words, civil society is an important source of information, not only for the citizens, but also for the government. Because remember, civil society works hand in hand with the government in order to deliver. Next. Now, the other important point of who are the participants or subjects of participatory democracy. So when you talk about participatory democracy or civil society, who are the participants? Who are the subjects? So if you look at the point, you say that it requires citizens to get involved in the governance process. So point number one, we are talking about citizens to get involved in the governance process. So the subjects are the citizens of the country. Now, but then the question here is that should we also admit residents, those who are living in the country? What about youngsters? Only people over 18 should participate, or may even younger people? Because remember, in some countries, when you talk about participatory democracy, we're also looking at basically elective democracy, whereby here we are talking about what? We are talking about, for instance, like the aging vote, the age of voting. So first of all, we are talking about citizens. But what about residents? For instance, a country like Indonesia, we have citizens, but we also have residents living in the country there. So should they also participate in participatory democracy? What about the youngsters, the young people here? Are we only talking about those who are 18 years of age? What about the role played by elective representatives? Because this is also a very important argument, because we have different schools of thoughts. Because there are those who are saying that there is no need for participatory democracy. Why there is no need for participatory democracy? Because we have elected representatives. So in other words, the elective representatives, they will basically do what? Represent our wishes or our voice. Next, please. Now, what about civil society? Who are the participants? Who are the subjects? So basically, like as I've mentioned earlier, when you talk about civil society, we are looking at a non-profit organized groups, clubs, associations in society that operate independently from the government and the state. That is very important. Civil societies must operate independently from the government. Because if they cannot operate independently from the government, then they will not play a very crucial role of a check and what balance. Next slide, please. Now, what are the challenges to participatory democracy and civil society? So basically here we have some challenges. We have to accept it, whether we like it or not. Challenge number one, that it is time consuming and expensive. It could take longer to react in a time of crisis. Because remember, that's why some writers are saying that there is no need for participatory democracy, because we already have elective representatives. So the elective representatives, actually, they can represent our wishes. So that is why they are saying that it is time consuming. Because if you want to come up with an important decision, then the argument is that you go back to the people and basically try to find out what are their views or opinions. So that's why we're saying that it is time consuming and also very expensive. High level of participation is required from both the citizens and the government. And that may not be something that is possible. High level of participation is required from both the citizens and the government. Deadlock on policies. Now, this is again very important, because you may not reach a compromise. That is, we are looking at, for instance, the citizens are saying this and the government basically is saying this. So at the end of the day, there is a deadlock on what? Policies. And then that basically becomes a problem. Tyrannical on minority rights as the other form of government. Now, this is also another important point, because remember, when you talk about elective representative or elective democracy, we are talking about the majority. which of course is also questionable, the majority there, because in some countries, the electoral system that they have adopted actually does not reflect the majority, the will of what? The will of the majority. So that is, again, there is a question mark there. But what I'm trying to say here is that another challenge with regard to participatory democracy is minority rights, because we are talking about consensus. Now, the consensus here we are talking about here, they may sideline the views or the opinions of the minority group. So this is also very dangerous. Poor institutional design. So poor institutional design, because you're talking about what things like, for instance, basically, as far as participatory democracy is concerned, some view it as a threat to elective democracy. And because it is viewed as a threat to elective democracy, then of course there is always basically what kind of like loggerheads between the proponents of elective democracy and also proponents of what? Of participatory democracy. So in the end, we have poor institutional what? Design in place. Next, please. Now, what about civil society here? So when it comes to civil society, we do also have some challenges. What are some of these challenges? Government restrictions, lack of government support, because in some countries, civil societies are viewed as a threat. The government is not welcoming the idea of having what? Civil societies. So that is why we are saying that in some countries, they will come up with all sorts of restrictions in order to suffocate the operation of civil societies. And as a result of that, civil societies basically have been viewed in some countries, especially developing countries, civil societies have been viewed basically with an eye of suspiciousness. Now, issue of accountability and independence. Now, this is again very important, because remember, as a civil society, you need to basically have enough kind of like what? Funding. So if you don't have enough funding, you don't have enough finance, then meaning to say that it becomes very difficult. That is why in some countries, especially developing countries, you find that actually they are colluding with the government. So instead of actually playing the role of a check and balance to the government here, they seem to be siding with the government. And as a result of that, to the eyes of the people, they are saying that, where is the accountability? Where is the independence? Now, the other important point, of course, is financial constraints. So most of the civil society organizations basically are donor funded. They get their money from what? Donors. And as a result of that, in most cases, they are handicapped. And being handicapped, they are unable to perform. Then we have new actors emerging, for instance, like the corporate entities. So also basically operating side by side with them. And then also the other important point is lack of capacity in terms of knowledge. So skills and methods of advocacy. So that has hampered or hindered the operation of civil societies, especially in developing countries. Next, please. So the question is that how do we, I'm coming already to my end of my conclusion, my discussion very soon. So how do we make participatory democracy and civil society work? So basically, when it comes to participatory democracy, we are saying that for participatory democracy to work, point number one, we must adopt the policy of inclusion. So in other words, we have to make sure that all actors are engaged. For instance, here, the need to have two partners who are willing and able to work together. That is the citizens or the community and the government. So the policy of inclusion is very important. Number two, engagement of institutional representatives, engagement of all the actors involved. So if you are appointed, for instance, if you are elected, for instance, as a member of parliament, now the question here is that you have to basically do what? You have to make sure that you consult your constituencies before big decisions are made. Now, the other important point, of course, we are talking about influence on what? The decision, which is very important. Access to information. Because if you don't have access to information, then the question here is that you will not be able to participate in the what? The decision-making process. That is why we are saying that access to information is very important. Political culture is also very important. We need to basically have a government that accommodates participatory democracy, but not seeing participatory democracy as a threat. And then, of course, institutional setting is also very important. Next slide, please. So what about civil society? How do we basically make it work for civil society? Now, the first point is that need for democratization level of the government. So this is very important. It is the government that provides civil society organization with the necessary conditions and access to public decision-making process. So in other words, the government has to be open. The idea of democratization level of the government is very important in order for civil society to perform. There should also be an increase and focused networking among civil society groups to aid training of cadres in grassroots mobilization and advocacy, because that's one of the problems they are facing, lack of skills, lack of training. So that should also be put in place. Need also to sanitize and strengthen civil society groups so as to ensure effective service delivery through the creation of an enabling environment for their operation. So our message here is that the government should not view civil societies as a threat, but rather the government should view civil society as basically playing an important role of a check and what? Balance. So in other words, that kind of environment needs to be created. Now, the other important point, of course, need to maintain a high degree of independence from the government. This is very important. Because if the civil societies, they are going to depend on the government, then there is no way that they can actually be viewed by the people as playing an important role. So that is very important. Diversification of sources of funding through creative revenue generation activities. Because at the moment, in most developing countries, the money comes from basically from donors. But then the question here is that the moment these donors are engaged with these civil societies, it is also very dangerous. Dangerous in the sense that they will end up basically dictating for basically what the civil society is supposed to do and what the civil society is not supposed to do. So these are basically some of the problems. So that brings me to the end of my discussion or presentation. So I think I will pass it to the moderator of the program. So that's all from me. So all in all, I would say that civil society, participatory democracy are key important elements when it comes to development in the 21st century. Without these two key important elements, a country cannot achieve that sort of development. Thank you, that's all from me. That's all from me.
Question from the audience. Thank you, Dr. Ahmad Waso, for your very nice and amazing presentation. And then we have many questions from the audience. Doctor, I will read one by one. The first question is from the lecture of radiodiversity from Mr. Roni. The question is, what is the role of presidential government if there is both a institutional design and deadlock of policies? We have a poor institutional design and deadlock of politics. So what is the role of the government for solving this problem? Is it clear, doctor? Hello? Dr. Ahmad Masuk, can you hear my voice?
Let me unmute first. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, I repeat once again. What is the role of Brunei Darussalam government if there was a poor institutional design and deadlock on policies?
Come again, I cannot hear you.
Okay, I repeat once again. What is the role of Brunei Darussalam government if there was a poor institutional design and deadlock on policies?
Okay. So, hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, okay. Very clear?
Okay. Yes. Okay, so as far as the role of Brunei Darussalam as a government or as an independent state is very, very clear that what is actually happening in Palestine, it is something that should not be happening in the 21st century. First of all, the people of Palestine, they have been denied a lot of their rights. The rights, for instance, to housing, because their houses are being demolished day and day. Freedom with regard to practicing their beliefs or religious belief that is also under attack. They cannot even go and perform, for instance, like Salat and Masjid Aqsa. So basically, Brunei Darussalam's position is very, very clear. We condemn what basically is happening, is taking place in Palestine by the Israelis. And of course, as far as the government is concerned, the government basically made it very clear through its envoy, and then that message basically was passed through the ASEAN World platform, saying that Brunei Darussalam as a country totally condemn the act of atrocities committed against innocent Palestinians.
Thank you, Dr. for your presentation. Next, the question from University of Kuningan, West Java, Dr. He asked about when does the civil society so afraid to criticize the government or tell their opinion?
Come again?
Yeah, I repeat once again. Well, the civil society so afraid to criticize government or set the opinion that there is no freedom of opinion even in the democratic country that prioritize the opinion of the people. What should we do?
Okay,
I repeat once again, yeah?
Yeah, that is why. Okay. That is what I...
Yeah, what should we do if we have the civil society so afraid of criticism government or set their opinion? So if we have the citizen and afraid to deliver the opinion about the politics, so what should we do to make them be brave to deliver the opinion or presentation? What is your opinion?
Okay, that is what I have said in my presentation, because we, as much as we have the pros, there are also cons. I did mention that earlier. Because the problem is that in most developing countries, we have a problem, the operation of civil societies. Now, the civil societies are seen as a threat to the establishment. That is why I mentioned earlier that access to information is very important. Because if there is no access to information, then the civil societies, the so-called participatory democracy, it will not work. So in other words, the government should basically have proper policies in place whereby democratization process is very, very important. I know it is very difficult, but then the question here is that civil societies, they have to play their role. They have to continue playing their role, because the question here is that the civil societies have to go back to the people and explain to them that if this government is not listening, then come the next general election, you exercise your rights by removing this government from power. But again, like as I've mentioned earlier, the problem here is that in most developing countries, we don't have free and fair election. Our elections are full of corruption. So it is a very difficult situation. But the most important thing here is that if we want the system to work, then the government should be willing to basically allow an environment of discussion. Because if there is no environment of discussion, then it is very, very difficult to basically play the civil societies to play their role.
There are many participants, Doctor, for asking the question directly, so they will raise their hand. Is there any question from the participant directly, Mr. Peno? Yes, the participant, please ask the question directly. It's okay, you can raise your hand to ask the question to Dr. Ahmad Masoud. Do you have a question? Okay, we don't have any question from the chat box, Doctor. How is the importance of engagement of institutional representative in Brunei Darussalam? It is the question from the student of Law Faculty, Kari University.
What is, come again, the question, moderator?
Is the importance of engagement of institutional representative in Brunei Darussalam?
What is the
The importance of engagement of institutional representative in Brunei Darussalam.
Important judgment, what is it? I didn't get engagement, your question.
Engagement of institutional representative in Brunei Darussalam.
Okay, so institutional representatives. Again, that is a main. I mean, as far as Brunei as a country is concerned, because let me just give you an example to answer this question. I will just give an example like how basically the United Nations work. So if you look at the United Nations, so basically we are talking about the member states all coming together. But then the problem here is that as far as the United Nations is concerned, we also have the so-called the big five. So even if you have your representative at international level, the question here is that whether the voice of your representative at international level can be heard. Because it is pointless to have a representative at international level, but then the question here is that his or her voice is not being heard. Why? Because we have the so-called the big five. So the big five are blocking the voice of the world. So in other words, what I'm trying to say here is that we have no fair representation as far as developing countries and the so-called developed countries are concerned. Because we in the developing countries, we are always being considered as a second-class kind of what? Countries. Not given equal access, yes.
Okay, good. Good. Thank you, doctor. Yeah, there is a question from participant who raised their hand. Please, the participant, say your name and ask a question to Dr. Ahmed Masum. Who is the name from the participant? Yes, please.
Zainal Abidin.
Okay, Mr. Zainal Abidin, the time is yours. Please ask the question directly to Dr. Ahmed Masum.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Dr. Ahmed Masum.
Good afternoon to you.
I don't understand what is democracy, but I have to Dr. Ahmed Masum. What implementation democracy in Indonesia, and what different implementation in Indonesia and your country? Thanks.
Okay, that's a very.
Dr. Mr. Ahmed Masum.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Mr. Zainal. So actually, that was a very good question. So when it comes to what is actually democracy? Because you see, the problem that we have, we don't have a universal kind of definition of what democracy is. Because to some people, they look at basically democracy basically is what? It's basically the idea of the majority. So in other words, if something is based on majority views or majority opinions, then we have to accept it. But then the question also is that you may be accepting the views of the majority, but at the expense of what? Sidelining the views of the minority. So in other words, we have a problem here. So as far as democracy is concerned, what basically countries nowadays they are doing, because this is something that actually they invented it. The West brought it to us, and they're saying that this is how it is supposed to work. But then in some countries, what now they are doing, they are saying what? We are going to have our own way of understanding what is democracy. We have seen that, for instance, like through the Asian values. You may have heard of Lee Kuan Yew of Singapore when he came up with his idea of Asian values. Our democracy in Singapore is based on Asian values. Now, the same thing also when Mahathir was the prime minister of Malaysia, first Mahathir, second Mahathir also, it was the same idea. When you talk about democracy, we're also talking about what? Asian values. Because Asian, according to them, basically, they're saying that there are certain things that in the West, you may basically, because in the West, they are more of individualistic. Whereas in Asia, we are basically looking at what? Collective. The people. That's what they are saying. But then if you look at also in Africa, where I'm coming from actually originally, we also have a problem there, because we have some leaders who are also trying to propagate the idea of what? African values. But the problem of whether it is Asian values or African values, the problem here is that some leaders, they are abusing these so-called values, because these values are not universal. For instance, someone from Indonesia and someone from Malaysia, you may have different values, but you're all Asians. The same thing also in Africa. Someone from South Africa, someone from Kenya, someone from Tanzania, they're all Africans. But the question is that, do we have universal values as Africans? So that basically, so what countries now they are doing, they are basically designing their own way of what? Democracy, provided things are working out well for their country. So if the people are very happy with the way things are working out well, but I have to reiterate, I have to make a point here. We still have a problem because some people, they are abusing all this. For instance, in some African countries, you find that they are talking about African values, but actually when they just want to stay in power, they don't want threats from basically their opponents. There is no room for the opposition. You get the point. There is no free and fair election. So how are you talking about democracy when there's no free and fair election? So these are some of the problems we have.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Hello?
Hi?
Yes?
Okay, sorry, maybe I'm unmute, yeah. Still one more question, Doctor, from the student of Agriculture Faculty, Mr. Galu. The problem in participatory democracy mostly is the people don't care about the government because they're tired with the condition of its country. So can you explain how to boost the awareness with its country? How to boost the awareness of the citizen if they don't care about the government because they feel tired? Perhaps there are many promises from the government, so promise, so they feel tired and begin to disobey with the rule. And the question is how to can you explain how to boost the awareness with his country?
So this, okay, that's a very good question. Actually, I didn't mention that earlier. So you see, the problem is that when you talk about elective democracy, elective democracy, basically, there is no long-term plan. The plan is always short-term plan. For instance, in a country whereby after every 4 years, you have to go for election, you are only thinking about the 4 years. What is it that we are going to do? And then the other important point, of course, as far as elective democracy is concerned, we have what basically we call election manifestos. Now, they promise a lot. That is true. During election time, the leaders will promise a lot. They will promise you heaven on earth, that if we come to power, we are going to do this. If we come to power, we are going to do this. We are going to do this. We are going to do that. But then at the end of the day, after 4 years or 5 years, they have failed to do what? To deliver. And then they will come back to you saying that, you know what, give us another 4 or 5 years so that we complete our what? We complete our task or the plan. So that's why I mentioned that in order to make sure that government basically stick to its promise or promises, we need a strong participatory democracy. We need an environment whereby major decisions should not be just taken light like that by our elective representatives. The elective representatives, the members of parliament, if possible, please go back to the grassroots. For instance, if you look at countries like the UK, they have what we call the referendum. So you go back to the grassroots. So you ask their opinions, you ask for their views, what basically they are saying. Although it is time consuming, but then the question here is that you will make the right decision as a government. Now, the other important point, of course, we need also to have a very strong civil society, but civil society that is independent. Because if the civil societies we are talking about here are not independent, they will not be able to act as a check and balance. Yeah. Because the question here is that someone needs to be watching the government. And who is that someone watching the government? The civil societies will play that role. For instance, you look at the case of Amnesty International. We know basically the sufferings taking place in Gaza, you get the point, the West Bank, but where do we get the information from? Because the Amnesty International, every year, it will come up with a report. And because Amnesty International is independent, it is basically non-partisan, it will come up with an adequate report, basically pointing out that this is basically what is happening in Gaza, this is what is happening in West Bank, in terms of what? In terms of violation of human what? Human rights. So to make it, to summarize, basically, this problem, we can only overcome it by developing a culture of participation through participatory democracy. Governments should not basically say that because it is elected to lead for the next 4 years or 5 years, then people should not be consulted. People still have to be part of the decision making process. The same also goes to civil societies. We need a strong civil society organizations. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmad Wasong, for your very nice presentation. Yeah, so many questions for you because they are interested with your materi. Okay, next. Thank you, Dr. You can wait for the next presentation. Yeah, next presentation is from Mr. Fitri. Before Mr. Fitri delivers the presentation, I will read about the curriculum vitae of Mr. Fitri. Okay, Mr. Fitri Windradi, SHMH, is the Law Faculty Lecturer of Kali University Indonesia. He also the Chairman of Litigasi Biro Badan Hukum Kadiri University, and then the members of KRADI, our Indonesian Lawyer Assembly, and then also the local officer in several banks in Kadiri and Surabaya in Indonesia during 2008 until 2017. He also the researcher of national and international journal. Okay, I give the time for Mr. Fitri to deliver the presentation. Mr. Fitri, the time is yours.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity given to me to be a presenter in this international webinar. I say welcome to Kadiri Universiti's webinar to Mr. Yosef Akil and Mr. Ahmad Masum. I hope that we can share an excellent discussion of the topic and benefit each of us. As mentioned by the moderator, the next, I am Fitri Windradi. I am today presenting about character vision to answer the challenges of the 24th century. The development of the 20th century, what is marked by the use of information and communication technology in all aspects of life. Technology connects the world that transcends geographical barriers so that the world becomes borderless. Transportation technology provides convenience for long journeys. Through television media, event in one place can be directly known and in other places, they are very far away. Change in standards require adjustment to the world of education in preparing students. Information and communication technology, facilities communication between between community members and the world of work that is not limited by space and time. Global economic growth demands increasingly competence in every aspect. The market is no longer limited by geographical barriers, but becomes a global market. 24th century student need to be equipped with ICT skills and pay close attention to global economic developments. The learning process must accommodate this. A student such as Japan on 24th century skills, so student must learn to have them. The partnership for 24th century skills identifies 24th century skills including critical thinking, problem solving, communication, and collaboration. Video thinking means students are able to critically the science and knowledge, able to use it for humanity skills in solving problems, means being able to overcome the problems that is in the process of learning activities as a vital for practicing to face higher problems in daily life. Communication skills refer to the ability to identify, assess, utilize, and optimize communication tools, the techniques to receive and convey information to other parties. Collaborative skills, being able to collaborate with other parties to increase synergy. Meanwhile, according to the National Education Association, to achieve success and able to compete in global society, students must be skilled and have skills as communication, communicators, creators, critical thinkers, and collaborators. Responding to the phenomenon of changing labor needs and progress, school need to be prepared to face the challenges of the 21st century. An understanding in 21st century skills is important to contain to students. The achievement of 21st century skills is done by understanding the characteristics, achievement, techniques, and learnings, strategies that are carried out. Next.
Okay.
The learning process that is able to accommodate students' critical thinking skills cannot be carried out with a one-way learning process. One way our teachers' centered learning will cycle students critically in responding to a teaching material. Students receive material from one source with a tendency to accept and cannot criticize. The ability to think critically is built by exploring the material from a different and thorough perspective. The ability to connect knowledge with the real world is done by inviting students to see life in the real world, interpreting each teaching material for its application in life. It's important to encourage student learning in motivation, in particular in the world of basic education, which is still relatively accurate thinking the teacher's ability. The relate each teaching material to life will increase students' mastery of the material. Connecting the material with everyday practice and its use can change the development of students' potential. Mastery of information and communication technology is something that must be done by all teachers. In our subject, mastery of information technology that occurs not at the level of knowledge, but the practice of its use. Learning methods that can accommodate is related to the use of learning resources, starting from conventional learning resources to the use of digital learning resources. Students take advantage of digital resources, both online and online, creating information technology-based product with audio and audio visual. Collaborative skills show an attitude of acceptance of others, share off with others and together with others, achieve common goals. The collaborative learning paradigm facilitates students in being in their respective rules, implementing them, and being responsible individual attitude, willing to win on their own and working alone, villages, children, stability to prepare for their future. It's competencies that exist in each collaborative so that it can improve competencies and achieve results. Learning strategies that can facilitate students in saving 21st century skills must meet the following criteria: learning opportunities and activities using technology to active learning, objective, project, or problem-based learning. Relation between curriculum, focus on investigation, developed by student collaborative learning environment. Level, visualization, and using visual media to improve understanding using formative assessment, including self-assessment. Other learning opportunities and activities. Learning methods are adapted to the competencies to be achieved. Mastery of one competence C is achieved by various methods that can accommodate student learning styles in a balanced way. That's each student gets some learning opportunities. Utilization of technology, especially information and communication technology, for the student to follow technological developments and obtain various kinds of learning resources and media. Learning resources and project-based or problem-based learning, connecting students with the problems and encourage in everyday life, starting from the problem being inventorial and ending with the problem solving strategy. Student continuously students teaching materials and competencies in a structured manner. In project-based learning, problem solving is brought into real product that are product as a student. Based on work, problem-based learning, problem-based learning, or learning project also focus on student investigation and investigation. Language between curriculum or integrated curriculum allow students to connect between learning materials and competencies. Yes, learning can be more meaningful, and the benefits of learning something can be identified. This learning is supported by a learning environment which can maximize the potential of students, supported by high-level visualization, and the use of visual media can improve student understanding. As part of learning process, formative assessment indicates a process occurred through formative assessment and supported by self-assessment. Students are mentioned, monitored for their level of competency mastery, are able to diagnose learning difficulties, and are useful in placing learning in groups when learning is designed. The development of the global economic and demand in the world of work must be addressed by school in preparing students. The 24th century demand mastery of higher order thinking, critical thinking, mastering information technology, being able to collaborate and communicative. The process of achieving these skills is carried by paying attention to knowledge in two categories, namely the knowledge dimension and cognitive process. In the context of the national education system? Is this advisable connect of the advanced standard and basic competencies of each class so that it can provide an required platform for integrating learning in several subjects? After that, taking character education to respond to the challenge of 21st century is very important for the following reasons. The first, the 21st century that we are currently experiencing as referred by expert has created challenges that have an impact and on appearance of a crisis in the field of character. There are six challenges in the 21st century, namely integration of economy, maintenance of politics independence, technology and new colonialism in culture. The sixth challenge posed by the 21st century, either directly or indirectly, have an impact on the appearance of a crisis in the field of character. Integration of the economy, causing the emergence of the free market, which is full of competition. In order to compete for the market, the economic behavior can justify any means that is understandable bank interest. Shaping, gambling, and speculation, control of all assets and opportunities. Small business groups holding goods so that there's an imbalance between supply and demand, which causes an unreasonable increase in the price of goods and services, and so on. Furthermore, the fragmentation of politics in order to demand more democratic, fair, human, and equitable treatment sometimes leads to exercise democracy and act of anarchism. Meanwhile, interdependence in order to gain recognition from other countries sometimes has the effect of creating a strong state against hegemony of a weak state. Meanwhile, the use of high technology in the form of computers and digital technologies sometimes carry out provocations, standard fights, character, assassination, and so on. Meanwhile, the new colonialism in the field of culture has led to moral decadence, especially among the younger generation. Pragmatic, transnational, ironic materialist and scholaristic pattern and view of life causing become people to become hard, less interested in spiritual values and tend to follow lifestyle and taste that include is and to get out of that they can justify our means such as self and etc. Second, there are side of the times that can destroy the nation's future. There are several signs that a nation is headed for destruction, namely, one, the first, increasing violence among youth. Second, data running use of language and words. their increased self-destructive behavior, such as the use narcotics, alcohol, and free sex, before the varying of good and bad moral guidelines. 5, decrease work ethic, and then the lower the respect for parents and teachers, low sense of individual and citizen responsibility. The culture of distanity and the existence of mutual suspicion and violence among others. If it turns out the 10 signs of the times already exist in Indonesia. After that, the third, there are some people who have mental illness, namely the way of thinking and having feeling that are blocked by illusions, they actually prevent us from moving toward success. Symptoms of mental illness include complaining, as malicious fears, conflict, the choice of life, and not take place. The mental illness occurs among other things. A bad view of one's own ability and experience, bad environment, your recalls and peer education. These destructive fears include blaming other people, looking for excuses, looking for justifications, being of what takes, not being confident and having that truth. The symptoms of this mental illness are speak in the community, even in schools and in general attitude or behavior, which consists of a good and bad behavior. People who are diligent in worshiping, praying at the mosque, fasting obligatory and sunnah, performing the legitimate likes to read or memorize the Quran, give advice, speak softly and politely, respect parents, the next man and others, smile and like donating and so on are often called people with good morals. However, people with good morals also commit act that not commendable, such as destroying forest, including concluding illegal paying interest, committing corruption, accepting bribes, and even community educated adultery. Those people who are said to have good moral are not directly proportional to the ability to distance themselves from action that are probably by religion, ethics, moral, culture, and law. Such a person has been able to carry out good deed. That has not been able to distend or play with the deeds. Yes, at its time, there has been a kind of historian of the understanding of character, so that the character does not set in the overcoming the damage in the moral field, especially this related to this dishonesty. Fifth, currently there's transactional legal practice in all areas of life, namely that the service or goods received, a person must be a proportional to the Medicaid. This situation is not only in the economic field, but has also penetrated into the political, social, educational, and even religious field. In the political field, the goal is no longer to fight for ideas that reflect to the interests of the community, nation, and state, but rather to personal interests, parties, groups. In the social field, it's no longer based on the spirit of mutual assistance, which is based on humanity and sincerity. This can be seen in the household life of some artists who are married and divorced amicably because its partner is no longer able to satisfy economically and financially. Transactional law in the field of education, for example, can be seen in the attitude of the people who view the cost of education as investment capital that must be returned and profitable by means of digits, the moments, jobs that can make it easier to get money. As a result of such circumstances, educational programs that cannot be marketed are no longer in demand by the public. In addition, the educational costs incurred must also be balanced with the availability of complete and good facilities, satisfactory service from lecturers and administrative staff, and various other facilities according to the cost there involved. Education is currently in no longer carrying the mission of national character education, but rather as part of a business venture that seeks profit without paying attention to national character education. In this education, many products graduates like slick ready to buy with their dangers and on. This is why it is not surprising that nowadays various criminal acts and violence of laws, religious norms, and moral are widely carried out among students in particular and society in general. Sixth, that the formulation of national education in school is currently decreasing. Some students who are believed to be building the nation's character, such as Pancasila, moral education, Pancasila. Citizenship, education, character, education, and courtesy education are increasingly less attractive. Likewise, religious education related to moral development is that in the profession of cognitive religious knowledge. These various subjects are by subject related to the development of scientific and technological insights and skill that they are direct at producting intelligent and skilled human blends with the subject related to national character education that will lead to strengthening person, such as honesty, tolerance, humanism, egalitarian, pride, hard work, discipline, friendly, and etc. The formulation of character education in order to answer the challenge of the 21st century in educational institution to tertiary levels, both formal and non-formal, with the various aspect, vision, mission, goals, curriculum, speaking materials, method and approaches, educators and education staff, infrastructure, management and evaluation of and others. Must be formulated with a starting point on these problems. Character education goals. Character education, as I mentioned above, among others, is aimed at the emergence of attitudes and consent to command the good and say away from the rebel. This statement shows that is that in character education is a strong message to produce humans who have the awareness to build history, culture, and civilization. As has been done by world leaders or recent national figures in the past, just the purpose of national character education is to produce people who have historical, culture, and civilized awareness to be able to realize such a nation. It must also be accompanied by effort to create a national character that has a strong intellectual tradition, namely characters who devotes love the truth and not speak justification. The second, honestly and authentically. The third, respect for knowledge, and for correspondent cosmopolitan. This intellectual tradition was practiced by Muslim in classical time, when Muslim appeared as guides for the history, culture, and civilization of mankind in almost all over the world, in a period of more than seven centuries. Another strategy that can be done in character education in 24th century is to look for the causes of the poor character of the nation, in addition to causes that arise from oneself, namely the influence uncontrolled also from outside, namely from this lay instill values that are contrary to the values of the nation. Character education in the 21st century can also be done by changing the paradigm of character education to a more substantive one. That is not a character that only appears on the surfaces, but people as something born from an inner calling, a spiritual and transcendental dimension on faith in God, as well as an awareness that affecting humans, there is always supervised by God, and later will be held accountable in the therefore thereafter. In addition, character education in the 21st century can also be pursued by realizing democratic education by fulfilling the following requirements. First, the practice of education always emphasizes equality and justice. Second, the learning process must lead to the development of one's own cultural abilities. These abilities include self-awareness, understanding and respect for other cultures, being able to cooperate with various cultural differences. It's individual continues to be given to the opportunity to develop and avoid this is his her ethnic identity. Character education in the 21st century in schools is further directed at effort to cultivate personal work ethic. The characteristic of which include having a leadership spirit, always introspecting, value time, never feel satisfied in doing good, develop a life-setting and efficient, have an entrepreneurial, healthy, competitive spirit, desire to be independent, strong, cohesive, in science and experience, and then macro oriented, pay attention to health and nutrition, tenacious unfolding, productivity oriented, and the last arranging the network of relationship with the others. Furthermore, to be able to implement various methods and approaches to 21st century character education in school and other educational institution, it can also be done by depending on the character of the school itself. Depending the educational institution as a vehicle, as it is known that the modern school education system is also difficult. The expand to be able to give birth to human beings with character, which is because the character of the school itself does not support national character education. Some things that can be identified as bad character schools include the still schools that low dishonest practice in saving assessment, such as allowing students to sit in a showing exam question, or even even letting exam question to the student by in return for sum of money. Determination of evaluation result that only emphasizes cognitive, intellectual intelligence and skills, without being balanced with moral and spiritual intelligence, library practice and recommendation in the admission of new students. There are unscrupulous teacher who commit sexual and acts of violence. The absence of school culture and culture that encourages the group of critical, independent and responsible attitude, and there are even a number of school principal and university leaders who are suspects in corruption cases. the character of the school, which is expected to shape the character of the nation, can also be done by applying the following two things. First, by implementing democratic and multicultural education in schools. Democratic education is a process in which students participate in deciding that will affect school life.
Okay, Mr. Fidri, two more minutes. The time is almost up.
Okay, closing. The closing one. Okay. Belanding that course must also develop literate skills. Finally, the wise attitude that must be taken is to be willing to accept change, consider the outside, like okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Fitri, for your very long and nice presentation, I think. Okay, Mr. Fitri, we have two questions from the audience, one of from Mr. Jatmiko from Kadi University Indonesia. The question is, why the education character is so necessary in the 21st century?
Why is character education so necessary in the 21st century? The more advanced technology is, it can shape character values. That's the foundation of character education in the 21st century. It must be strengthened so that later people can become human beings who have personality and hold accountable things of the charge.
Okay, yeah. Next question, Mr. Fitri, from the student of law faculty, that's from your student, yeah. How is the form of strong personality in responding the future challenges?
The more advanced technology is in a tempered character, one of the ways to form a strong personality is to provide opportunities for the nation's next generation to innovate, think critically, to be able to solve problems and be independent. That means that we must build the ability and innovation within ourselves. This is also the effect of the independent learning program as formulated by the Minister of Education and Culture, Republic of Indonesia.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Fitri, for your next presentation. Next, we come to the third presenter from Morocco. Before he present the material, we will say sorry because there are some trouble of internet in his apartment, so they can't join this meeting. But he has sent the material about this webinar, and we will read by the co-worker from Mr. Yosef. But first of all, I will read the curriculum vitae from Mr. Yosef. Yeah, the curriculum vitae from the first doctor. Mr. Yosef Bakil is a researcher in the public law and political science in the Faculty of Law and Political Science at Stanford University, Morocco. He also the General Secretary of Center of Research and Studies on Migration and Human Rights and the Local Coordinator of Studies for Liberty. This is an international organization oriented based in USA and has department in all world countries. And an international speaker all about the conference. And for the background of the study, he finishing the Master of Arts Public in 2017 until 2020, and that the License Science Juridic in 2016 until 2017, and in 2014 until 2016, the Diploma of the EUHN Science Juridic, and 2014 until now, Bachelor Letter of Science Humanities. Okay, please share the share screen from the material from Mr. Yusuf Bakir, and we read by Maha Fuadi, co-worker of Mr. Yusuf Bakir. Hello, Maha. Have you joined? Okay, hello, Maha. Thank you for your joining this participant. Okay, we will share the screen, and Maha will help Mr. Yusuf because there are some internet issue in the apartment. So Maha will share the screen of his material.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yeah, okay. I can hear you. Okay, thank you, Maha. You can read the material. Please okay. Share the screen, the computer. Please share the screen, the computer.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I hope you doing well. I want to start this presentation by thanking all the team for the efforts they made to make this webinar successful. Mr. Yusuf had the intention to be part of it, and unfortunately, he's not available now. So I'm here to introduce his topic instead of him and try to give you some points about it. So before starting, let's talk about participatory democracy, which can also be called as a participative democracy. It's a model of democracy in which citizens are provided power to make decisions, to make political decisions, and take part of the political life. There is four types of democracy, as we all know. Direct democracy, representative democracy, constitutional democracy, and monetary democracy. So now I will give you some points about the Moroccan case and how Morocco deal with the democracy in the Moroccan constitution. As a part of the 2011 constitutional revision and the context in which it took place, which is the Arab Spring, a new constitution was adopted in Morocco with very important constitutional novelties supporting the human rights situation in Morocco, and with the new principle in the context of the modernization of the states and the adaptation of the concept of the rule of law. Among these new concepts and related to our subject, we will talk about the concept of participatory democracy as one of the concepts created in the Moroccan constitutional and legal system. This concept is considered to reflect democratic practice in Morocco after 2011. It establishes new rules for democratic practice, allowing citizens to participate in decision making and monitor the execution and evaluation of these decisions. The Moroccan Constitution of 2011 defined a series of articles to frame the concept of participatory democracy. For example, the Article 6. The law is the supreme expression of the will of the nation. All natural or legal persons, including public authorities, are equal before it and required to submit to it. The public authorities are working to create the conditions that will make able to generate, to generalize the effectiveness of the freedom and the equality of citizens, as well as their participation in political, economic, cultural, and social life. The principle of constitutionality, hierarchy, and the obligation to publish legal norms are affirmed. The law cannot have retroactive effects, which means that, for example, if a law is established, we cannot apply it before the date it was established. civil society associations and non-government organizations are set up and exercise their activities in college freedom in accordance with the constitution and the law. They cannot only be dissolved or suspended by the public authorities by virtue of a court decision. Associations interested in public affairs and non-governmental organizations contribute within the framework of participatory democracy to the environment, implementation and evolution of the decisions and projects of elected institutions and public authorities. These institutions and powers must organize their contribution in accordance with the terms and conditions set by law. The organizations and functioning of organization and non-government organizations must be in accordance with democratic principle. The public authorities are working to create consultation bodies with a view to associating various social actors in the development, implementation, and evolution of public policies. The citizens have, under the conditions and the modalities fixed by an organic law, the right to present proposal in legislative matter. The citizens have also the right to present petition to the public authorities, and organic law determines the conditions and modalities for the exercise of this right. The territorial organization of the kingdom is based on the principle of free administration, cooperation, and solidarity. It ensures the participation of the populations concerned in the management of their affairs and promotes their contribution to integrated and sustainable human development. Participatory mechanisms for dialogues and consultation are put in place by the councils of the regions and the councils of other local authorities to promote the involvement of citizens and associations in the preparation and monitoring of development programs. The citizens and the associations can exercise their right of petitions in order to request the inclusion on the agenda of the council of a question falling within its competence. Public services listen to their users and follow up on their observations, proposals, and complaints. They report on the management of public funds in accordance with the legislation in force and are subject in this regard to monitoring and evaluation obligations. These articles frame the participation of citizens in the management of work affairs within the framework of participatory democracy and civil society. In connection with our project, Morocco's experience in participatory democracy and the role of civil society in economic development. Based on the above, we present the following problems. Within the framework of participatory democracy, what role for civil society in economic development? The plans will be interested below to help the reader to touch all the points which we approached on this subject. A, the conceptual framework. 1, participatory democracy. 2, civil society. And 3, economic development. B, the role of society, the role of civil society in economic development in Morocco, which means the impact of civil society on the economic situation, and the role of civil society in the evaluation of the social and the economic situation and in the reduction of poverty. So let's start with A, the conceptual framework, participatory democracy. Etymology, from the Greek demos, people and kratos, people and kratos, power authorities, and from the Latin participatio, to participate. Participatory democracy refers to all the devices and the procedures that make it possible to increase the involvement of citizens in political life and to increase their role in decision making. It finds its basis in the shortcoming of representative democracy. Parliament not representative of the diversity of society, remoteness of elected officials from the field and from daily reality, failing for citizens not be interested by politicians, distrust of politicians, weak check and balances, increase in abstention. Participatory democracy is inspired by the concepts that were implemented from 1960 in many companies in order to improve the organization of workstations. Compared to representative democracy and direct democracy, participatory democracy is presented as a mixed system in which the people delegate their power to representative who propose and votes on law, but nevertheless retain the power to size themselves of the matter. Some caution. The characteristic of participatory democracy are the extension of the right to vote and its frequency accompanied by legislative initiative via, for example, petitions. The dynamic cooperation in the form of free debates concerning decisions, both locally and nationally. For instance, advisory committees, district council, etc. The establishment of an organized system that ensures that all constitutive and new ideas from citizens will be effectively considered. A system of participatory democracy will be the more sustainable when the measures decided upon are acceptable to the vast majorities of those concerned and go in the direction of the common good. Criticism of participatory democracy mainly focus on the nation of participatory democracy, which is often only a system rhetorical discussed without concrete reality. It's sometimes associated with populism, the representativeness of citizens participating in the debates, the role of council and committees, which is often limited to the consultation aspect, forgetting the exchange between actors aspect, the difficulty of knowing whether the opinions expressed are based on objective considerations or on the defense of personal interests. The difficulty of knowing whether the opinions, as I said, expressed are based on objective consideration or on the defense of personal interests, but also the difficulty of verifying the veracity of the information used for the argumentation. The success of participatory democracy would come from our democracy living little opportunity for citizens to participate effectively. Second, civil society. For a country and a nation, civil society is all the players and associations, more or less formal organizations, movement, lobbies, interest groups, think tanks, which have a non-governmental and non-profit character. It constitutes a form of self-organization of society in citizen initiatives outside the state or commercial framework. Its objectives are based on general or collective interests in various fields, such as socio-political, solidarity, human champion, ethical, legal, environmental, scientific, cultural, etc. For the European Union, in its white paper on governance, civil society brings together in a participatory trade union and employs the social partner, non-governmental organization, NGOs, professional association, charities, grassroots organization, organization that involves citizens in local and municipal life, which is specific with a specific contribution from church and mosques and religious communities. Two types of historical and normative reference dominates the practice and analysis for real civil society. One designed a set of non-governmental institutions constituting the fabric of civility, the sense of peacefully expression of difference and disputes within the framework of the rule of law. It postulates a functional relationship between civil society and the state, the foundation of liberal political order. The other is which participates directly in the return of civil society, considers it in its relationship to the state in the mode of dualism, organized in a completely independent manner from state bodies. Civil society would be the vector of moral conscience in of an alternative approach tending to undermine the foundations of an authoritarian political order. Three, economic development. Etymology from the Latin of prefix of the cessation of negation and velver, to veil, to cover, to wrap. Development is the act of growing, of progressing, of expanding, of becoming more complex over time. Economic development refers to the positive developments in the structural changes of geographical areas or a population, demographic, technical, industrial, health, culture, social, etc. Such changes generate the enrichment of the population and the improvement living conditions. This is the reason why economic development is associated with progress. Economic growth is only one component of development. The latter can be measured using indicators such as gross domestic product, human development index, human poverty indicator, etc. Now let's talk about B, the role of civil society in economic development in Morocco, the impact of civil society on the economic situation. The main sources of foreign exchange are tourism in Morocco, foreign direct investment and remittance from Moroccans residing abroad. Civil society also helps bring foreign exchange, a significant part of donor support to civil society associations, based primarily on non-profit goals, and it relies primarily on funding and grants to conduct to its activities. Through the above, we clearly see the role of civil society associations in providing foreign currency and its positive impact on the economic situation. Regarding the role of civil society in reducing public spending, Morocco bears a great deal of financial burden linked to public spending in several sectors: employment, strengthening of social protection, achievement of financial and economical stability, and provision of sources for development spending. Civil society associations reduce government spending and help it fulfill its key role, providing employment opportunities, full-time, part-time, or even in training, as well as the voluntary work carried out by these associations, where this association contribute to the preparation and training of executives who work in many fields, whether in the fields, the environment, sport or health, development or public affairs in general. So now let's move to the second point, which is the role of civil society in the evolution of the social and economic situation and its and in the reduction of poverty. Morocco's experience in participatory democracy and civil society, with all its components, especially associations and cooperative, is an innovative experience where it has given a model and an example of poverty reduction and change of the social and economic situation, and will address both of the role of this associations and cooperatives in reducing poverty and changing the social and economical situation. A, at a level of association. Now let's talk about associations. The number of associations in Morocco exceed 400,000. Associations working in several fields, as I said, public affairs, environment, arts, sports, etc. These associations play a major role in changing the social and economic situation of their members and citizens in general, especially associations work in the field of social and economic development. These associations offer real opportunities for change through the various activities, training, seminars, support courses, development projects, artistic and cultural activities, etc. These activities contribute to the training, supervision, and production of future executives and managers. And now let's move to B, at a level of cooperative. The number of cooperatives in Morocco exceeds 20,000 cooperatives, including women cooperatives, agricultural cooperatives, housing cooperatives, etc. According to the above statistics, these cooperatives are mainly active in the agricultural sector. Cooperatives help reduce poverty rates in rural communities through income-generating activities. For example, in certain villages, women meet regularly in a cooperative framework, engaged in the production of honey or breeding or agricultural activity, or, for example, traditional industries activities, etc. These activities carried out by these women within the framework of cooperatives bring the financial benefits through the sales of their products. Thanks to the above, these women have a financial income through which we clearly see the role of these cooperatives in the evolution of the social and economic situation of the citizens. All this is part of the social and solidarity economy. These cooperatives play a very important role in saving Moroccan families, especially rural families, from poverty and changing the social and economic situation of these families. Instead of conclusion, in this regard, we discuss the concept of participatory democracy from a constitutional and theoretical point of view. We also discuss the concept of civil society as an implement that can only live in participatory democracy. Also, we approached economic development as a reflection of the social and economic status of citizens. To throw everything before, we tried to analyze the status and the role of the company civilian economic development, highlighting the activities of associations and cooperatives as a component of the most important civil society and the role of these various activities in achieving economic development. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mona, for your nice presentation. Okay, we come to the end of this seminar. Before we close this seminar, I would like to read about the conclusion for this seminar from the presenting from Mr. Fitri and then Maha and Dr. Ahmad Masu. We can make a conclusion that the concept of participatory democracy from a constitutional and theoretical point of view and of the civil society as an element that we obtain life in the participatory democracy. And the approach of economic development as a reflection of the social and economic status of citizens in Morocco. To everything before we try to analyze the status and the role of the company civilian economic development. In highlight the activities of association and cooperative as components to the most important city society and the role of these various activities in achieving economic development. And from the education aspect, the participatory democracy in 21st century can be done by preparing and ensuring that students have the skills to learn and innovate our educators. In the millennial era, must establish capacities and competencies according to the needs of the time. And the participation through deliberation of the citizen and civil society are the key important concepts that prove that still has developed in the 21st century. And creating a foundation for the participatory democracy partnership requires two partners who are willing and able to work together. This is the conclusion from our amazing webinar today. Before I close the seminar, I would like to invite Mr. Fitri and then Madam Maha Fawadi and Dr. Ahmad Masu for turn on the camera, and the all participants, please turn on the camera. We will make a photo session for the documentation. So I need the help from Mr. Seno to screen shot. Are you ready, Mr. Seno? Okay, for the all participants, please turn on the camera and the speaker. We take a picture together. Can I count from now? Please keep your best smile for our amazing webinar today. Are you ready all? Okay. 1, 2, 3, go. Finish. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sina. Okay, Dr. Ahmad Masuk, Mahal Fuadi, and Mr. Fitri, thank you for your witness to join this seminar. Hopefully, this seminar will be benefit for all of us. And for all participants, thanks for your participation for this seminar. Have a nice day. From on behalf of Law Faculty of Study University Indonesia, I, as moderator, I apologize if we have many mistakes in during this seminar. Thank you for your participation. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and bye-bye.
Waalaikumsalam.
Bingung kuliah di mana? Universitas Kadiri mempunyai 6 fakultas dan 21 program studi. Fakultas Hukum, program studi S1 Hukum dan S2 Hukum. Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik, program studi S1 Administrasi Publik dan S2 Administrasi Publik. Fakultas Pertanian, program studi S1 Agroteknologi dan S1 Agribisnis. Fakultas Ekonomi, program studi S1 Ekonomi Pembangunan, S1 Manajemen, dan S2 Manajemen. Fakultas Teknik, program studi S1 Teknik Sipil dan S1 Teknik Industri. Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan, program studi D3 Kebidanan, D4 Kebidanan, S1 Kebidanan, Pendidikan Profesi Bidan, S1 Keperawatan, Pendidikan Profesi Nurse, S1 Farmasi, D4 Teknik Laboratorium Medis, D3 Teknik Elektromedis, dan Pendidikan Profesi Apoteker. Info pendaftaran. Ketik link http://pendaftaran.unik-kediri.ac.id/. Tata cara pendaftaran. Setelah terbuka halaman awal pendaftaran, lalu pilih daftar atau daftar kesehatan untuk Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan. Masukkan data diri Anda. Login dengan menggunakan NIK dan password yang Anda masukkan. Halaman dashboard setelah login, lalu bayar biaya pendaftaran menggunakan nomor virtual account yang didapatkan. Jika sudah, akan mendapatkan nomor pendaftaran dan bisa melakukan tes online pada tautan yang ada di dashboard. Jika dinyatakan diterima, kemudian upload dokumen yang dibutuhkan. Kemudian bayar tagihan registrasi dengan nomor virtual account yang diperoleh. Registrasi mahasiswa baru untuk mendapatkan NIM. Isi data diri dengan benar dan lengkap sesuai dengan isian yang diminta. Universitas Kadiri memiliki 4 jalur pendaftaran. Jalur prestasi. Untuk calon mahasiswa yang lulus pada 2 tahun terakhir atau bebas tes, dengan mengunggah prestasi minimal di tingkat regional atau menggunakan nilai rata-rata rapot 8-10. Jalur KIPK. Jalur KIPK merupakan beasiswa untuk calon mahasiswa yang kurang mampu dan memiliki kemampuan akademik dan telah terdaftar di laman kip-kuliah.kemendikbud.go.id. Jalur reguler. Jalur reguler untuk semua calon mahasiswa baru lulusan SMA atau sederajat yang mendaftar di Universitas Kadiri. Dan jalur transfer. Jalur transfer untuk mahasiswa pindahan atau ahli jenjang atau lintas jalur di semua angkatan. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam fasilitas seperti Gedung Olahraga Surya Kadiri yang digunakan para mahasiswa untuk kegiatan olahraga. Dalam Gor Surya Universitas Kadiri juga dilengkapi fasilitas olahraga seperti basket, futsal, bulu tangkis, tenis meja, dan fitness center. Musola. Perpustakaan yang dilengkapi dengan ratusan buku untuk referensi, sekaligus berbagai hasil penelitian mahasiswa Universitas Kadiri. Laboratorium komputer dengan berbagai alat yang memadai dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Laboratorium bahasa yang dilengkapi dengan fasilitas full internet dengan kapasitas 50 orang mahasiswa. Galeri investasi merupakan sarana untuk pembelajaran dan diskusi bersama tentang pasar modal. Laboratorium sipil dan laboratorium industri, greenhouse dan laboratorium pertanian, peradilan semu, laboratorium farmasi, ruang microteaching, dan aula sebagai sarana kegiatan para mahasiswa. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam prestasi, antara lain klasterisasi perguruan tinggi urutan 48 pada klaster 4, SIM Katmawa peringkat 102 nasional. Universitas Kadiri juga memiliki beragam unit kegiatan mahasiswa atau UKM yang berprestasi, antara lain UKM Kerohanian Islam, juara 3 Tilawah Quran 2019, UKM Olahraga Futsal, juara 1 futsal antar mahasiswa se-Jawa Timur. Mahasiswa berprestasi nasional, juara 1 Pekan Olahraga Mahasiswa Nasional 2019. Mahasiswa berprestasi internasional, juara 1 Tenis Meja Internasional. UKM Seni Menyanyi, juara 2 nasional. Dan Galeri Investasi memperoleh prestasi, juara 1 Banking and Finance Festival. Mari bergabung bersama Universitas Kadiri untuk mewujudkan cita-cita Anda. Bingung kuliah di mana? Universitas Kadiri mempunyai 6 fakultas dan 21 program studi. Fakultas Hukum, program studi S1 Hukum dan S2 Hukum. Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik, program studi S1 Administrasi Publik dan S2 Administrasi Publik. Fakultas Pertanian, program studi S1 Agroteknologi dan S1 Agribisnis. Fakultas Ekonomi, program studi S1 Ekonomi Pembangunan, S1 Manajemen, dan S2 Manajemen. Fakultas Teknik, program studi S1 Teknik Sipil dan S1 Teknik Industri. Fakultas Ilmu Kesehatan, program studi D3 Kebidanan, D4 Kebidanan, S1 Kebidanan, Pendidikan Profesi Bidan, S1 Keperawatan.
Recording stopped.
Thank you. rem yo, sumpah. Mana anak rong rem, presisi. Goro-goro di gua ini.